बच्चन रचित चंद लाइन पढ़कर मेरे दिन की शुरुआत करता हूं। आपने भी बहुत बार सुनी होंगी ये लाइंस एंड बिलीव मी इट गिव्स मी इमेंस एनर्जी एट दिस टाइम। लहरों से डरकर नौका पार नहीं होती, लहरों से डरकर नौका पार नहीं होती, कोशिश करने वालों की कभी हार नहीं होती। नन्ही चींटी जब दाना लेकर चलती है, नन्ही चींटी जब दाना लेकर चलती है, चढ़ती दीवार पर 100 बार फिसलती है, मन का विश्वास रगों में साहस भरता है, चढ़कर गिरना गिरकर चढ़ना न अखड़ता है। आखिर उसकी मेहनत बेकार नहीं होती, आखिर उसकी मेहनत बेकार नहीं होती, कोशिश करने वालों की कभी हार नहीं होती। इट रियली गिव्स मी इमेंस एनर्जी, सो दैट्स व्हाई आई शेयर इट विद यू। सो वेरी डियर जेसीएफ फैमिली एंड अवर गेस्ट फ्रॉम ऑल ओवर द ग्लोब, वेरी गुड इवनिंग एंड अ वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू यू ऑल। आफ्टर अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग एंड सक्सेसफुल फर्स्ट टॉक ऑन प्रेजेंट लेबर लॉज एंड हाउ टू मेक योर ब्रांड गुड टू ग्रेट बाय मिस्टर राजीव अरोरा एंड मिस्टर आर के जैन, where our moderator was Jayashree G. Periwal, we are back with you today. We are here before you with our second in the JCF webinar series, Hum Tum Second, with world-renowned author Mr. Amish Tripathi, in conversation with our very own Dr. Jayashree Periwal on the subject Lessons from the Past. On behalf of our trustees, JCF members and guests, I welcome Mr. Amish Tripathi and dear Jayashree ji. Now I would like to request Shri Rajiv Arora, Chairman JCF, to formally introduce our most esteemed guest, Mr. Amish Tripathi, and our own Dr. Jayashree Periwal to you, and also speak a few words. Over to Rajiv ji.
Thank you, Jaju sahab. Bahut sundar aapne shuruaat kari hai, to ant bhi bahut sundar hoga. मुझे खुशी की बात है कि आज हमारे बीच में बहुत ही सेलिब्रेटेड राइटर अमीश त्रिपाठी आपके हमारे सामने रूबरू हो रहे हैं हम तुम के अंदर। ये जो सेशन है उसका पहला सेशन हमने शुरू करा था जिसमें मैं एज ए स्पीकर था और आर के जैन साहब थे। ये दूसरा सेशन है, मैं अमीश जी को आपसे इंट्रोड्यूस कराऊँ। उससे पहले मैं जे सी एफ की टीम को और जागृति की टीम को धन्यवाद देना चाहता हूँ फॉर देयर हार्ड वर्क जो भी COVID-19 के समय वो कर रहे हैं और उन्होंने जो सेवाएं दी हैं, खास तौर से इस देश के सबसे बड़े ओपीडी अस्पताल जो है SMS हॉस्पिटल में, उसको सरकार ने रिकॉग्नाइज करा है। वी हैव रिसीव्ड अ लेटर टुडे फ्रॉम SMS एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन, वो मैं आपको पढ़ के सुनाता हूँ। जयपुर की तरफ से लेटर है, राजीव अरोड़ा, चेयरमैन जयपुर सिटीजन फोरम जयपुर। ग्रेट सपोर्ट फ्रॉम जयपुर सिटीजन फोरम फॉर सपोर्ट ऑफ मेनी मिसलेनियस आइकन्स ड्यूरिंग COVID-19 लॉकआउट। डियर सर, वी रियली एक्नॉलेज एंड थैंक यू फॉर ऑल द सपोर्ट प्रोवाइडेड टू अस फ्रॉम द वेरी बिगनिंग टिल कंटिन्यूअस ड्यूरिंग COVID-19 लॉकडाउन। द आइटम्स गिवन बाय यू लाइक वाटर, की, कॉफी, बिस्किट्स, मफिन्स, fruits, packaged food, etc. in huge quantities were of great help to doctors, paramedical staff, patients of COVID-19. We have received items as per enclosed list. We also acknowledge Jagrati, the big support in transportation and volunteering help in these tough items. We doctors, hospital staff and paramedical staff of COVID-19 and patients admitted of COVID-19 of SMS hospital, once again, thank you from bottom of our heart for all your most appreciable efforts and great help to mankind during these most tough times for the whole world. Here we all also acknowledge and thanks from bottom of our heart to your trustee, Mr. Jayakishan Jaju, in person, also for his daily personal interaction, guidance and support in our day-to-day work all through this period. Best regards, Dr. Randhir Singh Rao, he is additional medical superintendent, SMS Hospital. I would like to thank SMS Hospital, and this shows the work we are doing, and this kind of motivation makes us strong, and we are committed to do this kind of philanthropic work in future also. So now come to the main point. हमारे बीच में क्योंकि आज अनीश त्रिपाठी आए हुए हैं, बहुत ही मशहूर साथी हैं, बहुत मशहूर राइटर हैं, लंदन से हमारे बीच में आए हैं, उनका वेलकम है. आई वुड लाइक टू इंट्रोड्यूस हिम इन फ्यू लाइन्स. अमीश इज ए डिप्लोमेट, ऑथर एंड कॉलमिस्ट. ही हैज टेकन ओवर एज डायरेक्टर ऑफ द नेहरू सेंटर इन लंदन इन अक्टूबर 2019. अमीश हैज बीन लिस्टेड अमंग द 50 मोस्ट पावरफुल इंडियंस बाय इंडिया टुडे मैगजीन इन 2019. फोर्ब्स इंडिया हैज रेगुलरली रैंक अमीश अमंग द टॉप 100 मोस्ट इन्फ्लुएंशियल सेलिब्रिटीज इन इंडिया. अमीश वॉज ऑल्सो सेलेक्टेड एज एन आइजनहावर फेलो at prestigious American program for outstanding leaders from around the world in 2014. Amish published his first book in 2010 and has written 7 books till date. His books have sold 5 million copies and have been translated into 10 Indian and 9 international languages. Amish is an alumni of the prestigious Indian Institute of Management, IIM Calcutta. He worked for 14 years in the financial services industry before turning to writing. So before I hand over to Jayashree Periwal, who is a moderator, I would like to introduce Jayashree. Is our own. She is a co-chairperson of JCF and also the famous Jayashree Periwal Institutions and Schools in Jaipur. And she is managing that. She is giving education to the society, considering Vidya Dan is the biggest dan. सबसे बड़ा दान है विद्या दान करना. आने वाले समय में इसके बाईस स्टेप से जयश्री केजरीवाल इंटरनेशनल स्कूल बना और ये एक विश्वविद्यालय बने, दुनिया में नाम कमाए. इन भावनाओं के साथ तो जयश्री केजरीवाल आप और हमारे बीच में से हटके अमीश त्रिपाठी के साथ. थैंक यू वेरी मच.
थैंk you. Thank you, Amish, for being with us. I've had this privilege of knowing this lustrous luminary for many years now. His journey has been exemplary and an inspiring one. He's taken the youth of our country back to our roots and back to our culture. We warmly welcome you. My first question, Amish, aaj ke is lockdown ke period mein, kya hum us Ayodhya mein hain जिसमें श्री राम नहीं है, या हम उस वनवास में हैं जिसमें हम अपना अस्तित्व छुपा रहे हैं, या उस वीरान हस्तिनापुर में हैं जिसको मालूम नहीं कि कौन सा युद्ध हो रहा है और किसके लिए हो रहा है.
नमस्ते. थैंक यू सो मच फॉर हैविंग मी. बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद और आभार आपका. जयश्री, बहुत सालों के बाद फिर से मिल रहे हैं, बहुत बड़ा अच्छा लग रहा है. आपका समर्थन तो I've had it from my first book and thank you so much for this grace. देखिए, शायद मैं तो ये कहूंगा कि जो मानव जाति जो है, शायद हम लोग धर्म की खोज में निकल पड़े. देखिए, हम कहते हैं कि कोरोना एक वायरस है, लेकिन वायरस की परिभाषा क्या है? वायरस को हम लोग डिफाइन कैसे करते हैं? वायरस एक ऐसा प्राणी है जो बिना सोचे समझे बस रिप्रोड्यूस करता रहता है, ग्रो करता रहता है, ज्योमेट्रिक ग्रोथ होता रहता है उसका. और जो एनवायरमेंट से उसे जिंदगी मिल रही है, वायरस इन अ वे इज हाफ अ लाइफ, इट डजंट हैव अ डीएनए, कोरोना वायरस, इट ओनली हैज एन आरएनए,
करेक्ट,
बट एंड इट फाइंड्स लाइफ इन अ वे बिकॉज इट्स एबल टू प्रोड्यूस प्रोटीन फ्रॉम अ सेल. तो जिससे उसे जिंदगी मिल रही है वो उसी सेल को बर्बाद कर देता है. ही ड्रॉज सो मच आउट दैट ही डिस्ट्रॉयज द सेल ओनली, इट, राइट,
करेक्ट.
भाई ये डेफिनेशन तो हम मानव जाति के ऊपर भी लगा सकते हैं, हम भी वैसे ही हैं. हमारी आबादी इतनी बढ़ रही है, ज्योमेट्रिक ग्रोथ, और हम मां प्रकृति पे से हम लोग इतना छीन रहे हैं वी आर इन मेनी वेज डिस्ट्रॉइंग द एनवायरनमेंट.
करेक्ट.
तो एक तरीके से आप कह सकते हैं कि शायद माँ प्रकृति के दृष्टि से, फ्रॉम द व्यू ऑफ द एनवायरनमेंट, शायद हम खुद ही ह्यूमन बीइंग्स आर द वायरस, हम खुद ही वायरस हैं, और माँ प्रकृति ने शायद कोरोना वायरस को उत्पन्न किया है कि मानव जाति जो वायरस है इसके ऊपर कुछ नियंत्रण हो. आप देखेंगे, हाँ ठीक है, हमारे लिए मानवों के लिए तो बहुत एक कठिनाई का समय है. द लास्ट मंथ, मंथ एंड हाफ, टू मंथ्स, हम सब घर में बंद हैं. हम सब तो थोड़े लकी हैं कि सिर्फ घर में बंद हैं, कई लोग तो ऐसे हैं जो बेघर हैं, जिन्हें खाना नहीं मिल रहा है. लंदन में भी ऐसे बहुत लोग हैं. या लेकिन दिस इज व्हाट द ह्यूमैनिटी इज एक्सपीरियंसिंग राइट नाउ. लेकिन अगर आप जानवरों की दृष्टि से देखें, जो पेड़ पौधे हैं उनकी दृष्टि से देखें, जो नदियां हैं जो उनकी दृष्टि से देखें, तो शायद पिछले 1.5 महीने तो बहुत अच्छे हैं उनके लिए. वेनिस में डॉल्फिन्स दिख रहे हैं. हमारे मुंबई के कोस्ट में जहाँ पे मतलब पानी इतना गंदा होता था कि कुछ दिखता ही नहीं था, वहां पे डॉल्फिन्स आ गए, वेल्स आ गए. दिल्ली की हवा इतनी मतलब सालों में शायद इतनी साफ नहीं थी. तो मैं ये नहीं कह रहा कि हमें दैट वी हैव टू रिमेन स्टक इन दिस. लेकिन क्या हम मानव जाति, क्या हम इससे कुछ सीख सकते हैं? ये जो आपदा जो आई है हमारे ऊपर, हमसे हम क्या हम इससे कुछ सीख सकते हैं कि यस वी शुड हैव इकोनॉमिक ग्रोथ, वी हैव टू, क्योंकि स्पेशली भारत में बहुत गरीबी है, वी नीड इकोनॉमिक ग्रोथ, गरीबों को उनसे बाहर निकालना है. लेकिन इज दिस एक्सेस कंज्यूमरिज्म रिक्वायर्ड? और अगर हमें उसे सुख भी नहीं मिलता है, आई एम लिविंग इन द वेस्ट नाउ, आई एम हियर फॉर 3 इयर्स, आई एम अ ब्यूरोक्रेट, I'm in the foreign service for 3 years. Mm-hmm. West is a place of excess consumerism. लेकिन यहाँ पे excess consumerism से लोगों को खुशी तो नहीं मिल रही.
Yeah.
तो चीजें खरीदते जा रहे हैं लेकिन मन को शांति नहीं मिल रही, खुशी नहीं मिल रही, तो फायदा क्या है उसका? और माँ प्रकृति पे इतने पाप भी कर रहे हैं हम. तो क्या ये हमारे लिए एक अवसर है कि हम इससे कुछ सीखें और हमारी जो जिंदगी है, जो हमारी जीवन शैली है, जो हमारी जो कंज्यूमरिज्म की जो प्रणाली है, इस पे क्या कुछ संतुलन लाया जा सकता है? कैन वी फाइंड सम बैलेंस?
करेक्ट.
शायद ये एक अवसर है हमारे लिए, और अगर हम ये कर पाए तो शायद ये हम धर्म को भी पा सकेंगे. प्रभु श्री राम तो हरदम यही कहते थे हमें कि धर्म को ढूंढो.
So the lessons that we've learned, even the Pandavas were in exile, they learned to live within their very limited means.
Correct.
Frugality.
Correct.
And I think going back to nature, respecting nature, and that's what we are learning today. And thank you, Amish, for reiterating this. Let's go to your books, or let's go to the social fabric around us.
Ji.
In your bestseller, Sita, you've candidly stated that Ravan wasn't a thug, a villain. He was simply a brilliant scholar and, of course, a devotee of Lord Shiva, which even you are. But he had a tainted ego, severe anger management issues, like any young professional nowadays, especially the corporate honkers. You belong to one of those. In today's Kali Yuga, would Ravan still be considered sinister, villainous, as he was considered in the times of Ramayan, Ayodhya?
देखिए, हमारे जो पूर्वज थे उनका नजरिया हरदम ये होता था कि लोगों को जज करने में कोई फायदा नहीं है. यू नो, जो अंग्रेजी शब्द जजमेंट जो है, जहां पे कोई कह रहा है कि आप सही हैं, आप गलत हैं, आप स्वर्ग जाएंगे, आप नरक जाएंगे, ये कॉन्सेप्ट ही नहीं था. तो इसके लिए वैदिक संस्कृत में शब्द ही नहीं था. जजमेंट, न्याय इज नॉट जजमेंट, न्याय इज जस्टिस. जजमेंट जहां पे कोई कह रहा है कि आप सही हैं, आप गलत हैं, ये कॉन्सेप्ट ही नहीं था. भगवान भी किसी को जज नहीं करते थे. हमारे साथ जो भी होगा वो हमारे ऊपर था, हमारे कर्मों का फल हमें मिलेगा। लेकिन हरदम कहते थे कि फल की इच्छा मत करो, जो कर्म है उसी पर तुम्हारा हक है, कर्म करो। तो अगर जजमेंट कॉन्सेप्ट ही नहीं था तो फिर हमारे जो पूर्वज थे वो हर चीज को इस मापदंड से देखते थे कि ट्राई एंड अंडरस्टैंड रादर देन जज। वो क्यों कहते थे कि जजमेंट इज अ वेस्ट ऑफ टाइम, क्योंकि दूसरे के कर्म, दूसरे के जिंदगी पर हमारा कोई काबू तो है नहीं। वी हैव नो कंट्रोल ओवर देम। द ओनली थिंग वी हैव अ कंट्रोल ओवर इज ऑन आवर ओन कर्म, इज ऑन आवर ओन एक्शंस। तो जजमेंट इज अ वेस्ट ऑफ टाइम, किसी और के ऊपर जजमेंट करने का क्या फायदा है। आप किसी और को देखिए और उसे सीखिए ताकि आप अपनी जिंदगी में कुछ सुधार ला पाए। तो एटीट्यूड हरदम ये होता था कि दूसरों से सीखें। तो हमारे जो देवी देवता थे उनकी तरफ भी एटीट्यूड ये होता था कि उन्हें देख के, दर्शन करके हम सीखें और अपने जीवन में
उतारें,
जो जो सीख मिले, जो लेसन्स मिले उसे उतारें। तो रावण को भी से, और ये सिर्फ देवी देवता को नहीं देखते थे, जो असुर थे उनको भी, जो राक्षस थे उनको भी, उन्हें देखिए और उनसे सीखिए और अपने जिंदगी में उतारिए। तो रावण से हम क्या सीख सकते हैं, और यही ये मॉडर्न इसमें भी कहूंगा, देखिए रावण वॉज वेरी वेरी टैलेंटेड, नो डाउट अबाउट, ब्रिलियंट इंटेलेक्चुअल, बहुत बहुत बड़ा योद्धा था, वेरी गुड वॉरियर, बहुत अच्छा राजा था, ही वॉज अ गुड एडमिनिस्ट्रेटर, इसलिए तो सोने की लंका थी, बिकॉज ही न्यू हाउ टू रन इट वेल। लेकिन उसमें एक बहुत बड़ी खामी थी, एक तो गुस्सा और दूसरा ईगो, महत्वाकांक्षा। तो और इसका, और वो आपने सही कहा, वो शिवजी का भी परम भक्त था और प्रभु श्री राम भी शिवजी के भक्त थे। तो शिवजी का आशीर्वाद भी था रावण को, लेकिन फिर भी हिज एंड वाजंट गुड। तो इससे हम क्या सीख सकते हैं कि अगर आपके पास रावण की काबिलियत भी हो, अगर आपका अपने ईगो पर कुछ नियंत्रण नहीं है तो फिर जिंदगी अच्छी नहीं जाएगी।
You will have a fall. Pride has a fall.
Correct. तो शायद रावण से हम ये सीख सकते हैं that it is in our own selfish interest to control our ego. We are not doing a favor to anyone else. We are doing a favor to ourselves by controlling our ego. And if someone as talented as Ravan could suffer because of his ego, then hum kaun hai?
Correct. You know,
Amish, control your ego.
You know, Amish, the plight of women or the status of women today and yesteryears was a lot different. You know, through the books and movies and Ramanand Sagar's Ramayan, we've seen Sita as being obedient, demure, exploited. And on the other hand, Kekayi, as we know, has been conniving, wicked, vampish stepmother. And she's never been looked at as an astute, politically savvy queen. So somewhere our depictions are very monochromatic. Does this popular representation of characters from the social fabric, have women's representation been purposefully designed to reaffirm patriarchy? Should we not change the mindset that it cannot be a Purush Pradhan nation? You have given a muscular makeover in your books, which we are so indebted. Every woman of India bows down to you. Your attempts, really I'm telling you, your attempts to depict Sita as a tough, warrior, daunting, strong woman is the one who actually goes and kills Ravan. A deliberate attempt to change the perception of the reader and change the mindset of the society. You're encouraging gender equality. Was that your purpose of depicting Sita the way you've done?
You know, I think the way we see Sita Ma in modern popular culture is a relatively recent interpretation. in the ancient versions of the Ramayana, Sita Maa is very, very strong. So I'd love to take credit and say ki I myself have invented it. I'm not. I'm just reviving an ancient way. So, as you rightly said, I mean, in the original Ramayana is the Valmiki Ramayana, and the version that you referred to was the Adbhut Ramayana.
Sagar.
But even in the Valmiki Ramayana, and I respect Ramanand Sagar ji, he did a very good job. But look, his was an interpretation for his era. But if you see the original ancient Valmiki Ramayana, in that Sita Maa is a very, very strong character. She's not a warrior, but she's a very, very strong character. And there is a version of the Ramayana that I've spoken of quite a lot. It is also credited to Valmiki ji, called the Adbhut Ramayana. There are a few Ramayans that have been credited to Valmiki ji. One is, of course, the original Valmiki Ramayana. The other is the Adbhut Ramayana. And another one is the Ananda Ramayana. Correct. And there are differences in these, and all three have been credited to Valmiki ji. And there are differences in all these three Ramayans. In the Ananda Ramayana, for example, it begins with a fierce battle between Ravan and Lord Dashrath close to the sea. So I've interpreted that actually into my books. It's not there in the Valmiki Ramayana, but it's there in the Ananda Ramayana. In the Adbhut Ramayana, however, you're right, Sita Ma is the one who kills the elder Ravan. There are two Ravans, that version of the Ramayana, the younger Ravan and the elder Ravan, the Sahasra Ravan. And Sita Ma is the one who kills the elder Ravan, the more powerful Ravan. And there's a very wonderful line in there. You know, I'm sure all of us know the Mahabharata line, Yada Yada Dharmasya Glanir Bhavati Bharata. Everyone, I'm sure, knows that line. There's a different interpretation of that line in the Adbhut Ramayana. Yada Yada Dharmasya Glanir Bhavati Suvrata Abhyutthanam Adharmasya Tada Prakruti Sambhav. That, remember, O keeper of righteous vows, Suvrata, matlab keeper of righteous vows. Remember, O keeper of righteous vows, whenever dharma is in decline or adharma rises, the mother, the sacred feminine, will incarnate and she will defend dharma. Essentially protect us. That is the version that that is there in the Adbhut Ramayana.
So Amish,
so that is the version I was inspired by.
So Amish,
no one can claim that their version is the truth. I don't claim my version is the truth.
Amish, can you
only Lord Ram knows the truth.
Can we on a lighter note say that our creator Vishnu ji gave all the high profile ministries to women. Education Saraswati ji ko de di, Durga ji ko de di, defense, or finance de diya Lakshmi ji ko, aur Narad ji reh gaye information and broadcast ministry ke liye. Is that so? So moving on. I don't think we in our country, where our education system is concerned, we haven't given too much weightage to mythology and history.
True.
We suffer from this colonial hangover even today.
Very true.
We study Pythagoras theorems and not Bhaskaracharya. We study Plato and not our own Upanishads. I mean, why can't we do Shakespeare as much as we do Kalidas? I really want to put forward that we must take pride in who we are, from where we come from. And also I'd like to give credit to Bollywood, because they've been doing their little bit in giving us historical blockbusters like Bajirao Mastani. At least they made our history more readable, and say Padmavat. Your books have led to a revolution of interest, connecting yesteryears to our tomorrows. What should Indian education system, what should they do to popularize our own literature?
I think not just in literature, but in across all subjects, the Indian education needs to become more Indian. We are still carrying forward with the colonial education system. I've spoken of this. This is an area of intense passion for me, so I've spoken of this quite a lot. And our entire education system is built along this line ki kisi bhi tarah hum sabko angrez bana de. And it's not just in the subjects that you quoted in maths or literature, but in every subject, like in literature, we'll have someone saying Kalidasa is the Shakespeare of the East. Arey, what nonsense! Kalidas ji was at a different level. I'm not belittling Shakespeare, but no, you can't compare him to Kalidas ji. The philosophical depth that Kalidas ji had was in a different league. And for Kalidas ji himself, he had said that the Sanskrit writer he respects the most, who he considers is the best Sanskrit writer ever, was Bhasha. Most Indians haven't even heard of Bhasha, or Shudraka. There are so many, in literature, then in mathematics, as you said rightly, Bhaskaracharya, Bodhayana, they aren't taught, in architecture, in governance, people will say, Chanakya was the Machiavelli of the East. Hey, what nonsense. Machiavelli ran one small city, Florence. Chanakya ran 1/5 of humanity. What the hell is the comparison? There is no comparison. And Machiavelli, in many ways, if you read, his text, it's almost amoral the way Machiavelli's approaches. But if you read Chanakya Niti or Arthashastra, it's certainly not amoral.
Yeah.
It's very dharmic. It's utilitarian. Yes. It is tough. Yes. But it is dharmic. It is not amoral at all. To compare Chanakya and Machiavelli is completely wrong. And if we have no knowledge of Chanakya, then we'll accept some Westerner or even Westernized Indian saying Chanakya is India's Machiavelli. Are you, what nonsense? We don't teach enough of our own roots. We have to Indianize our education system.
Yeah.
And I don't know itna hum log dar
jaate hain. You are in a power of position now. You're a diplomat. You're going to influence the government. We hope to see that from you. And what you've already done, please keep doing. Keep telling and retelling the stories of the past in a cool manner.
Thank you.
Because the millennials want to hear this. The tech world, these youngsters want to be a part. And to be a part, they want authors, think tanks like you. And I am an educator, and it pains me that we're always looking for validation from the West and taping them blindly.
Correct.
In today's current COVID world, I would say, that do you think that this materialistic West will now start looking at the spiritual India for guidance how to lead their life? Is our life similar to the Pandavas in exile? But they still remained spirited. They didn't give up. They fought the war and they won the war no matter what. And I'm sure we shall win the war from COVID. Your opinion?
No, humanity has defeated far worse diseases earlier. So COVID will get defeated. But let's be clear. This COVID crisis is not going to go away quickly. A vaccine being easily available across the world is at least 12 to 18 months away. Which means we will go through another winter cycle before we see the end of this. And all the economic devastation that's happening because of COVID is also going to be with us. Debt has shot up dramatically all across the world. I mean, fiscal deficits in the Western world will be 10, 15% of the GDP. These are humongous numbers. And it will take years and years to pay down that debt, and there will be an impact, of course, you know, on that in the future. Infrastructure spending, pensions for the old people, God knows what the impact will be. There will probably be, you know, changes in geopolitics as well.
Mm-hmm.
But one thing that I think that one will see in societies could go in two directions. In a out of what is essentially a global event like this.
Mm-hmm.
One direction is societies could rediscover traditions and spirituality. I think India will probably go in that direction. Many of our rural areas are still tied to our traditions. Uh-huh. But in urban areas, we had moved away, but we'll probably rediscover our traditions and spirituality. And luckily for us, our traditions are actually very liberal. So it doesn't mean that becoming traditional means that we will go against women's rights or LGBT rights. That will not happen. Our traditions are actually deeply liberal.
But
in the West, it could go in this tradition. They could also rediscover traditions and spirituality. Possible. I just did a recording with the BBC,
mm-hmm.
where they're asking people, the followers of different religions, that what is the way to manage this, the chaos, loneliness, mental troubles, physical troubles, economic troubles, everything of, how to manage it spiritually of this crisis. So I was asked to, speak on the Hindu point of view. For all you know, they may be interested in spirituality and tradition, the West. They could rediscover this. Or it could actually go in the completely opposite direction. The roaring 20s, time of hedonism and drugs and, everything, that in the 1920s. Mm-hmm. It was actually a result of the devastation of the First World War and the Spanish flu of 1918-1919.
Yeah.
When at that time, around 50 million people died. Remember, the population was much smaller at that time. 50 million people dying in 1918 is equivalent to around 200 million people dying today. So it was a massive number because of the Spanish flu. Okay, it was also an influenza epidemic. And there was the First World War. Then the reaction of many people in the West was, ki yaar marna in any case, might as well enjoy life.
No.
Okay. So that's what happened in the roaring 20s. They were just partying all the time. Correct? Hedonism, drugs, sab kuch. Okay. God knows, maybe the West could go in that direction. Or they could rediscover tradition. I don't know what the path will be.
I have this firm belief, Amish, that the power of the past is so great, be it for believers, atheists, or agnostics.
Mm.
The biggest proof of business today is using mythology for marketing. Look at our cool youth today. They'll be wearing Nike shoes, which is actually Nike is the god of victory. Versace, with its Medusa head logo, mythology has untapped potential.
There's a reason why Versace turns people into stone is because of that Medusa head.
We are going to be seeing more movies, TV, Netflix, books inspired by mythology. We're looking for your tries with mythology headed, and when are we going to see your work on celluloid is another thing, and I'm sure you're going to outdo the Avengers. It's going to be bigger, it's going to be better, and it's going to be a pride for our own India. And we are going to soon open questions for the audience, so jot them and write to them or raise your hand and we will unmute you. Answer this one, Amish, this last question of mine.
Yeah, so
marketing and mythology.
Yeah, no, there is a discussion going on a series and a movie deal as well. I mean, rights were given to a friend, Karan Johar. He's still a very dear friend. But unfortunately, it didn't work out for various reasons, and the rights are back with me now. Karan remains a very dear friend. So we are exploring different options, and I'll certainly keep you guys informed when we have something to announce.
Blockbuster hone wala hai. Another thing, Amish, today the world is not for the mightier in strength.
Hmm.
It's it's not how physically strong you are. It's how mentally sharp you are. Mm. It is about being empathetic. It is about EQ. So women and men should come to a more equal platform. Are you writing anything on this subject to make our boys respect the girls? Nobody better than you.
I don't know. I've written such stuff already. Sita Warrior or Mithila.
I'll
continue to write more. I genuinely believe that it is not just a dharmic thing to do to have equality between men and women. It is also the patriotic thing to do. It is good for the country.
Yeah, everybody.
Manu Smriti had said that the prayers, in any land where women are not respected, the prayers have no impact on the gods, because the gods abandon that land.
Yeah.
So it is a patriotic thing to do as well, to have...
I have so many questions.
Rights between men and women.
I can see Reena Bhandari with her hand up. Please unmute yourself and do ask a question to Amit.
Hi, Amit.
Hi, Reena. Aaji, bataiye.
It's an absolute honor and pleasure talking to you today.
Thank you, Reena.
I'm intrigued about certain things. That are you actually an ardent devotee of Lord Shiva? And that's what inspired you to write about the Shiva trilogy?
I'm a very, very ardent devotee of Lord Shiva. I always have an Om Namah Shivaya kada. I always have a Shivji, I have various Shivji ki murti is with me. You see my computer screen.
So then how...
I do a Mahamrityunjaya Jap every morning.
Wow, that's wonderful.
I'm a very, very devout Lord Shiva worshipper.
But then how do you document that he was just a simple man 4,000 years ago and today he's God? Wasn't he always God?
That's the, the thing is that we Shaivites, we look at it from various different perspectives. One is the Shivatva itself, right? That where he was as that, because we believe that he is the source, right? And the formless Nirgun Nirakar.
Yeah.
And essentially that divine exists in all of us. There are various different ways of approaching the divine in the way. And, there is of course the Nirgun Nirakar way. Then there is the Akar theory of God. And then there is the Avatar theory of God, where God is born, the God or goddesses are born as a human being, or as a living being, not necessarily a human being, do their karma and go back up. Or there's the fourth way, where actually all of us have the divine within already. The very word namaste means I bow to the divine within you. And the difference between the devas and devis and us is that they have discovered the divine within them and we are yet to discover the divine within us.
Lovely.
And I find that theory very inspiring. Now, in our dharmic way, by the dharmic way, I mean Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism, the four dharmic religions. There is no one truth which is the truth. And that if you don't follow this truth, you'll go to hell. So I'm not judging any other, truths about the divine. All I'm saying is that this theory of the divine, that divine is within all of us, and our journey is to discover the divine within. I find it very inspiring. The gods we worship as gods are those who've discovered the divine.
Lovely. The next is
coming
from Atul Kapoor. Can you unmute yourself, Mr. Kapoor?
Hi, Atul.
Hi, Amish.
Hi, Atulji.
Hi. So, my question is that, if you look at Ramayana or Mahabharata, there's a group of people, myself included, who believe that these are works of fiction created by the learned men of that time so that society would have religion and something to fear. So has the time come for people like you to be, the modern age Valmikis and to recreate, a fictional character, maybe the 10th avatar of Vishnu in the form of Kalki or whatever, and recreate this whole epic to make it relevant for the future generations. You know, I mean, that could be an amazing swan song for us from you.
No. The way I see it, I genuinely believe that Lord Ram existed, that Lord Shiva existed, that they were our ancestors.
But there was a point in time when you didn't believe it.
Yeah, I was an atheist, yes.
Yeah, yeah.
But atheist, remember, in the Indian way, because our faith is not militant, our atheists are also not militant. You'll realize that in the West, you see Western atheists, do you realize they tend to be very militant? They'll go looking for fights with people who are religious. Have you noticed that?
Yeah.
Why is that? Because Western atheism rose as a reaction, to the Catholic Church. You know? So, since at that time the church itself was quite militant, then the atheists also became quite militant. Right? Whereas the traditional Indian atheists, you know, which is the Charvaks, the Mimamsas, the Sankhyas, essentially those who don't believe in a creator God. I don't know if you're aware of the 12 major schools of philosophy in the Indian dharmic way. Five of them actually don't believe in a creator God. So there were five philosophical schools which are technically, by the modern definition, atheists. But it wasn't such a big deal in ancient India, because what was common in the dharmic way was not whether you believe in a God or not. What was common was the belief in dharma karma, the belief in reincarnation, the belief in the law of cause and effect. Faith was a personal choice. Now, so therefore, I believe that they are actually our ancestors, and maybe stories got embellished over time. And I can't say that I'm enforcing that point of view, because I have no proof of it. I'm just saying that belief gives me a lot of inspiration, because then I think like I have to be worthy of the blood that runs in my veins, right? And the way I see it is that all of us at every age, we have a right to come up with our own interpretation, which makes us closer to the divine. Because what is the journey? The journey is not to prove that our divine is stronger than someone else's divine. That's a very childish concept. You know, that's like a kindergarten fright, my daddy's strongest. That's very silly. The entire concept of spirituality is not to prove that my God is stronger than someone else's God. The entire concept of spirituality is to find spiritual peace within ourselves so that we are productive members of society. And if there's an embellishment of a story which gives us the momentum to do that, then that's a wonderful thing to do. That's spiritual work. That's the way I see it. So all of us have a right to do that, not just the storytellers, all of us.
Ananya is next with her question. Ananya, followed by Mihika. Unmute yourself, Ananya. Ananya. Ananya, can you hear? Yes. Anaya.
Yes. It's such a pleasure to be speaking with you, sir.
Hi, Anaya.
Hello, sir.
Oh, that's my head girl also.
Oh, yes. Okay.
Anaya, that's you.
Hi, Anaya.
Hello, sir. Sir, given the current circumstances, the leadership of our country has become more imperative than ever. Because we need our leaders to be very strong and to guide us through this obstacle. How do you think the leader of our country should be? Like Shiva, dynamic, intolerant toward injustice, or like Ram, peace-loving and forgiving?
I always get the smartest questions from the youngsters. the answer is not easy, because I'm not saying my theory is the theory, but at least in my theory, the Mahadevs are the ones who come to destroy evil, and the Vishnus are the ones who come to create a new way of life. Where are we at this point of time? Are we in a state where we need to destroy evil? Or are we in a state that we need to create a new way of life? The answer is not simple, because I think in some ways fossil fuels have turned evil, because they've caused so much climate chaos. And in my theory, what is evil? Essentially something that was good, but we've used it so much that it has become evil. You know, as the extremes of anything is not good. As our ancestors said, dati sarvatra varjayit, that excess of anything should be avoided. So is that the problem that we are facing, or is it that actually we need to create a new way of life, that this excess consumerism, you know, that we have is not good for Mother Earth, it's not good for society, it's not good for us individually also. And maybe this is a time to pause and reflect and rethink on our way of life. The answer isn't simple, which is why I actually have a lot of sympathy for our leaders. You know, I know it's fashionable to criticize all our politicians, you know, but I actually think that the way our leadership has managed this situation, and I've seen many other countries, you know, it's a real mess. Okay, the way our leadership has managed this situation is really pretty good, right? And considering that, you know, we are a very poor country. We are still a very poor country on a per capita basis. Our resources are small. We are stuck in a very difficult situation where we have to save lives. You know, you've seen the number of deaths that are happening, especially in the West. You know, in India, for example, the total number of deaths due to COVID, I think the last figure I read was some 700-750. In the UK, where I am living right now, every day, close to 1,000 people are dying. Every day. Matlab, to India, which is 15 times the population of the UK, India is 1.3 billion people. UK is only some 80 million people. Okay. The total number of deaths in India since when the COVID crisis began is less than the number of people dying in the UK every day. And we have done this when our health systems are, you know, let's be honest, we don't have that many hospitals. We don't have that many doctors. We are a poor country. So actually, it's pretty amazing what we have achieved. And the credit goes to our leadership. The credit goes to all of us people as well. You know, let's be honest. I mean, essentially, what has our leadership done? They've requested us to maintain a lockdown. But yeah, there are 130 crore of us. If actually most of us refuse to follow the lockdown, yaar police kya kar sakti thi? Itne to police wale bhi nahi hai.
Bilkul sahi.
The reality is it's working because most of us Indians are actually following the request from our leaders. And it's one of the interesting things about us Indians. You'll notice that in normal times we are very chaotic, completely chaotic. Kuch sab raam bharose hota hai. But in crisis times, suddenly we same Indians become very disciplined and focused. Have you noticed that?
Yeah.
Normal times, yaar, matlab pagal ho jaoge to get Indians to agree to anything.
Bilkul correct.
But crisis times, you know, ek ghante mein suddenly everyone is aligned. Correct? We are a very strange country in that way. So credit needs to go to our leadership, to our people. But let's be honest, we are not out of the woods. We have a long way to go, and the economic devastation that is happening because of this lockdown is terrible. It's terrible. Many businesses will go out of, will go bankrupt.
Population, yeah.
People will lose jobs. What is the way out? I don't know. All of us have to work on it together. And there are huge challenges for our leadership. There are huge challenges for us as a country. And एक तरह से एक तपस्या है वी हैव टू शो आवर कैरेक्टर
बिल्कुल और हम होंगे कामयाब विद दैट वी हैव लॉट मेनी हु हैव लॉग्ड इन फॉर क्वेश्चंस नेक्स्ट इज मिहिका फॉलोड बाय मेघ
बट जैसे आई हैव लाइक 5 10 मिनट्स मोर
यू हैव 10 मिनट्स मोर
हां 10 मिनट्स मोर
ओके कम ऑन मिहिका
नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन
हाय थैंक यू फॉर द वंडरफुल सेशन
हाय मिहिका
My question is that you've written about a lot of characters that are revered throughout this country and that have been part of centuries of storytelling. So in your writing process, have you ever faced maybe like a conscious choice of balancing sentiments, sensibilities while deviating from the popular narrative surrounding these characters?
You know, good question, Mahika. You know, the way I see it is I genuinely don't believe that I'm creating these stories. And you'll understand when I explain that, because, you know, before writing Immortals of Melua, I had not written any fiction in my entire life. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Immortals of Melua is the first, you know, I hadn't written a small story. I'd written nothing. Immortals of Melua is the first piece of fiction I've ever written in my life. And it, you know, became such a huge hit. I didn't even think anyone would be interested in reading it. And the way I write my books till today is I don't believe I am creating it. I don't try and control it. I just write the story the way it comes to me. You know, I actually kind of open my laptop and there's this parallel universe that opens up and I can actually see what is happening. And then I describe what I see. Since that's why it's such almost a spiritual experience for me, writing. It's the best part of my life when I write. Which is why, and I know hopefully you don't have to be nothing wrong with being an atheist in the Indian way. But if you are a believer, you'll understand, you know, that I genuinely believe my books are the blessings of Lord Shiva. Because I can't explain where this creativity comes from, because maine kuch asar nahi dikhaye the bachpan mein. कुछ आसार नहीं दिखाए थे मेरे जो
थैंक यू अमीश आई एम गोइंग टू द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन
या
सो अनम्यूट योरसेल्फ
सो देयरफॉर आई डोंट ट्राई एंड कंट्रोल इट आई जस्ट लेट इट फ्लो एंड देयरफॉर देन इट्स द लॉर्ड शिवा डिसाइड्स व्हाट विल गो इन द स्टोरी व्हाट विल नॉट
मेक एंड देन शिवानी सेठिया मेक अनम्यूट योरसेल्फ
हेलो अमीश एकम
सत्यम मेक हाउ आर यू
उदा वदंती
Yeah, right. I mean.
So, like you mentioned, all these different form of Ramayans. We have different Ramayans, and here we have one more classical piece of literature from Kalidas, Meghdootam.
Yeah.
So, I want to ask, like, is it just a fiction work again from Kalidas, or do we have mentions of it in different Ramayans as well? Just that's it.
No, you know, Meghdootam is, is essentially just a lover using the cloud as a laptop is running out of battery. Let me just put the charger. Meghdootam essentially translates as cloud messenger. So it is the story of a lover using the cloud to convey sort of like a love letter to his lover. That's what the Meghdootam is. There are of course plays of Kalidasa which have drawn on various mythologies as well, on various of the traditional stories, Ramayana, Mahabharata. So, for example, Kumar Sambhava, draws from the Shivpura. But the interesting thing where Meghdoota actually is linked to the Valmiki Ramayana is not in the story; it's actually in the language. Okay, in the Valmiki Ramayana, one of the things that most of the Sanskrit lovers see is the Valmiki Ramayana is very poetic, kind of literary, right? Whereas the Vedvyasji's Mahabharata is very, Vedvyasji doesn't spend as much time on crafting a beautiful sentence. He's more focused on get the philosophies out, get the story clear. Yeah, so the Mahabharata is much more, if you want to, in terms of language, is not focused on literary, on beautiful sentence construction. It's focused on, I need to teach you some philosophies. Speak of that, right? So in Meghdootam, the interesting thing, Kalidasa uses a description of the cloud, okay? That the cloud looks, if I remember correctly, he speaks of, it looks a bit like a gaja, the elephant. And which is very interesting because Valmiki ji, and Valmiki Ramayana was obviously much older than Meghdootam, Valmiki ji uses the exact same description, okay, for a cloud.
Moving on to Shivani Sethia. I'm sorry, Amish. I don't want to disappoint so many people who are listening to you. So, Shivani Sethia, please unmute yourself.
Thanks, Jayashree Aunty. Hi, Amish. I'm Shivani.
Hi, Shivani.
I'm a Kathak dancer and I live in London. I have been really inspired by all your books and especially Sita. I was brought up in Jaipur. No disrespect to any Rajasthani, but it's a very patriarchal society. We were told to behave like Sita. We were told to follow the system, follow our husband, cook for him, be the right woman as to say, after reading your version of Sita, I'll be very honest, I had not read any other version of Sita while I was growing up. And a lot of people in my contempt, who are my peers, probably didn't know this version of Sita until you wrote about her. And I would request that as a diplomat and as you have so many educationists around you, I think it would be a huge favor to all the girls of India if this kind of the version of Sita is introduced in the education system. And
excellent, I hope Shivani. Excellent.
It will be done very soon. I have a lot of questions for Amish. If I start, Jayashree Aunty, it will take up all.
Shivani, you got to be short because I have so many more waiting. Yes,
I will leave it at that. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Shivani. Thank you so much. You take care. Bye.
We have Arnav Ghatiwala.
Shivani, thank you so much for your kind words. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Amish. I hope to see you soon at some point once this is
certainly,
done.
Certainly.
Arnav Ghatiwala.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Hi, Arnav.
Good evening, sir. So I'm firstly a very big fan of yours, and it was amazing listening to you today.
Thank you.
I was recently watching Ramanand Sagar's Uttar Ramayan, and we see how Lord Ram, he exiles Sita Ma simply because she was living in Ravan's house, and all of the people who lived in Ayodhya, they wanted Ram to exile her. So Ram is generally taken to be someone who's always very righteous. How do you think he was righteous in, how was he right in exiling Sita and sending her away to the forest once again? And if you portray this, if you write about this, how would you portray it?
You know, because I know we are running short on time and the answer to this will be very long. You should wait for my interpretation of that story. That will be there in the fifth book of the Ramchandra series. Having said that, I'd written an article on this specific issue, which was I think it would come out in early 2014. You know, I think December 2013 or Jan 2014. It was in Hindustan Times. So just do a Google search, Amish Lord Ram, Hindustan Times. The article will come up, which and actually gives a detailed thing on this issue, and you can read my views on it.
Lovely. Can we have Parijat Agarwal?
Ma'am, can I add something? Agarwal. Can I add something?
Arnav, let's give a chance to everybody.
Sorry.
Parijat Agarwal.
I'm so sorry, Arnav. Yeah, you know, because we have very few minutes left and Jayashree's trying to bang in as many questions as she can.
Yeah.
Hi, Amish. I have a question for you. So, since this is lessons from past, some of the messages which are circulating are that, for example, Uttar Ramayan has this particular sloka 120, which specifically talks about bats carrying the diseases. Right? And there are other references in Mahabharata as well to bioweapons and stuff. So what do you have to say about, you know, was this predicted? Can we do something from Ramayana or Mahabharata to basically cure of this or whatever?
Ramayana and Mahabharata had guidelines on what to eat, what not to eat. It's difficult to say that predicted COVID, but it has guidelines on what to eat, what not to eat. Often it comes in the form of a story, you know. So a part, for example, when in the Lord Ram Sugriv Vali scene, Lord Ram actually speaks of the kind of meat that should never be eaten and the kind of meat that's okay to eat. And a lot of that was driven by disease. Remember the Ramayana and Mahabharata, one way to see it is they're not just stories, they're also educational. They teach you things. They're in some ways geography lessons. Like the Sugriv description of sending his people to search for Sita Ma is actually a geography lesson. Okay.
Right.
Or the Shanti Parva in the Mahabharata is actually a governance lesson, but it's in the garb of a story. So you don't resist it. So it has been well known in our India Ayurvedic traditions what kind of food should be avoided for diseases. Most people know that bats cause diseases. That doesn't mean that bats aren't important. They specify bats are important for Mother Nature. Right, they are very important. They keep pests under control. They, help in pollination. But that doesn't mean that we should eat them. Okay, that doesn't mean a prediction of COVID, but it has guidelines of what to eat, what not to eat. And Ayurveda, however, has certainly has a lot of lessons. We have not done enough scientific research of Ayurveda. And in fact, the many of the problem often with Western medicine, allopathy, is often the side effects are worse than the disease itself. So we need to explore Ayurveda scientifically a lot more. The government has started an Ayush ministry, but frankly, I think we need to do a lot more. There's very, very little that has been done.
One last question. Adi Ramnani, he's been there for a very long time.
Okay.
Adi Ramnani.
Hi, Adi. Hi. Adi is here. Hi. Okay. Hi, Amish. Tamish, I think you've had a fabulous academic career, as well as in terms of going to IMC and then working for illustrious banks like IDBI, Stanley, and then DBS. It's exactly a textbook of what a child would aspire to be in academics, and you've actually lived that career. The request to you, Amishji, is that all the students on the call, what is your message to them who want to pursue writing? How do they continue to build on that? How can they be illustrious writers the way you could pursue your passion for career in banking and then still continue with your passion in writing? What is your message to them? How they could continue to build on that?
You know, one of the things that I believe in life is that you should let your heart decide your destination, but use your mind to plot the journey. So essentially swinging on any extreme is not a good idea. You know, if you compromise with your dreams and don't listen to your heart at all, then when you're 70 or 75, you'll have hated the life that you've lived. But if you don't listen to your mind at all and just keep jumping where your heart tells you to, then you're going to, failure is almost guaranteed, right? So you need to find a balance between the two.
That is certainly possible.
I did that. I continued working in my banking job. I wrote my first two books along with my job. I resigned only after my second book when my royalty check became more than my salary. So it was, my decision was also practical and pragmatic, but I followed my heart as well. Find that balance. That's the only suggestion.
We have SS Bhandari Saab. He's our advisor.
Okay. Can you, absolute last question.
Yeah. Can you unmute yourself, Bhandari Saab?
Haji Bhandari Saab.
Oh, probably must have thought. I'm handing it over to Jaju Saab for a vote of thanks. There have been many more questions. We've learned from the past, but we've also learned from Amish. Thank you so much. And we're going to have you one more time at your convenience. Certainly. I have 20 more questions that are with me. Jaju ji.
Thank you very much, Amish. Thank you very much, friends. So, ab mujhe lagta hai, Amish ke sandesh ke baad tapasya shuru. Vishnu ki khosh shuru. This is the right time to go for Vishnu to create a new way of life. This is the right sandesha you have given, and thank you so much. It was brilliant.
Thank you.
It's really, really wonderful to hear you. And friends, thank you very much. See you again on Wednesday for a new topic. We'll tell you soon. Thank you very much. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Bye, guys. Thank you so much. Bye.